In the last lecture, we studied the nature of magnetic materials. We found that based on the atomic structure of the material, the magnetic material can be of any of the three types: diamagnetic material, which gets magnetized in the direction opposite to the applied field; paramagnetic material, which gets magnetized in the direction parallel to the field but weakly; and ferromagnetic materials, which get magnetized in the direction of the magnetic field but very strongly. The behavior of ferromagnetic material has been explained on the basis of the various domains which occur in the magnetic material. In each domain, the atomic magnetic moments are aligned parallel to one another because of exchange forces between electrons. In this lecture, we are going to study the Faraday's law of induction and Lenz's law. You see, we have seen that static charges produce electric fields. We have also seen that when we apply a potential difference across a conductor, then a current flows, that is, the charges start moving, and these moving charges or currents produce magnetic fields. So the question arises whether magnetic fields can also produce currents. This question occurred to the famous scientist Faraday. He performed several experiments and showed that changing magnetic fields do indeed produce currents. Changing magnetic fields, not static magnetic fields. The intimate relationship between electric and magnetic fields was studied by Maxwell. We shall study Maxwell's equations in the next few lectures. And the solution to Maxwell's equations showed that the light waves actually electromagnetic waves, which move with the speed of light. So what were these experiments which Faraday performed? Simple. We have a loop of a conducting wire attached to a galvanometer, and we have a bar magnet. When we bring the bar magnet near the loop, when we move the bar magnet towards the loop, there is a kick in the galvanometer showing that a current has been established in the loop. When we withdraw the bar magnet, again there is a kick in the galvanometer, but in the opposite direction now, showing that when the bar magnet is going away from the loop, even then there is a current produced in the loop. So these were the experiments done by Faraday. The important thing to notice is that if the bar magnet is there but is at rest, and the loop is there and there is no relative motion between them, then there is no current. The current is established only when there is a relative motion between the bar magnet and the coil. That is, the bar magnet can move towards the coil or away from the coil, or coil can move towards the bar magnet or away from the bar magnet. What is important is that there must be relative motion between the two. And one can also notice, if one does this experiment, that faster we move, say, the bar magnet or the coil towards the bar magnet, larger is the current produced. Instead of bar magnet, we can have two loops. You know, a loop is equivalent to a magnetic field. So we can have two loops of a conducting wire which are mounted on the same core, common core. Now, if you establish current in this loop, then as soon as you establish the current, magnetic field appears. That means there is a change in the magnetic field through this coil A, and therefore there is a kick in the galvanometer. Similarly, when this coil is moved away, again there is a kick. When there is a steady current flowing through this coil, that means magnetic field is steady, then there is no kick in this, there is no production of current in this coil. So it is always the relative motion between the two that is important. Or in this case, when the current is suddenly switched on, there is a kick, or when the current is suddenly switched off, there is a kick. Or if there is a steady current, then the motion of this coil towards this coil or away from this coil, or the motion of this coil towards this coil or away from this coil, will produce the current shown in the galvanometer. So it is always the relative motion. When the two are steady, there is no current produced in the coil. So this we have done. So let us again, when coil B with steady current, now steady current is moved back, there is again a current in coil A. When the steady current is there and this is there, there is no induction. Only when the coil with the steady current, which is equivalent to a bar magnet, when it is moved away or towards the coil, there is a kick in the galvanometer. So there is nothing special about the coil which is moved. It is a relative motion between the two coils or between the bar magnet and the loop that is important. And greater the relative motion, the greater the effect. We conclude from these examples that whenever the magnetic environment of a conductor is changed, an electric current is generated in it. This was an important discovery by Faraday, and that is why it is known as the Faraday's law. We shall see what the law says. What do we mean by magnetic environment? We mean the field lines around the loop, or the magnetic field going through the loop or linked to the loop, that forms the magnetic environment. And if there is any change, then the current is induced in the coil. When a magnet is moved with respect to the conducting loop, the number of lines of force going through the loop changes. You see, when I move this bar magnet towards the coil, then as it moves towards the coil, the number of lines of force going through the coil changes. Similarly, when I take it away from the number of lines of force change. Similarly, two coils. When coil B suddenly gets a current, becomes a magnet, the magnetic environment of the neighboring coil A suddenly changes. Current is induced in the coil. So whenever there is a change in the magnetic environment of a conducting loop, there is a current. So whenever there is a change in the magnetic environment of a conductor, an EMF is induced in it. Now what is this EMF? EMF, or its full name, electromotive force, is essentially the potential difference or voltage across an electric cell or battery when no current is drawn through it. That is, suppose this circuit, if I do not draw any current, then I take the potential difference across this cell or battery, then this would be the EMF of the cell or the battery. If the current is drawn, say current I is drawn, then some work is done in overcoming this internal resistance of the cell R. So therefore the potential difference across the cell is reduced by the amount IR. That is, I can write E minus IR is equal to I times R, or E equal to IR plus V, where V is the potential difference across the resistor. Now we have seen the effect which gives rise to the induced current. Let us now find out how much. That is, we now go to the quantitative content of Faraday's law. For that we need the definition of the flux. It is the same as in the case of electric flux. We have, let us say, surface, and the surface is in this case inclined. The normal to the surface, you know, normal to the first surface is inclined to the magnetic field. Then the flux, as in the case of electric field, the flux through this surface is integral of B dot dA. And if B is constant, I can take B out of the integral and the flux becomes B dot A. Remember that A, the area of this surface, is a vector. Its magnitude is equal to the area of the surface, and its direction is along the normal to the surface. So it becomes B dot A, which we can write as B A cos theta. And if this surface is that of a coil which has n turns, then the flux is equal to n times B A cos theta. For each turn, the flux is B A cos theta. For n turns, the flux is n B A cos theta. If the surface is normal, then theta is obviously 0, and phi is equal to simply BA. And now Faraday's law of induction states that the induced EMF epsilon is equal to minus d phi by dt. Minus sign I will explain in a moment, but the magnitude is d phi by dt. And if we use the expression for phi b, which is equal to nba cos theta, we can get any of these relations. In this relation, minus nb cos theta da by dt, it is a that is changing, that is the area which is normal to the magnetic field that is changing. In this nba sin theta d theta by dt, it is the angle that is changing, the area remains constant. See, area can change if, for example, the coil is shrinking, but if the coil is not shrinking, then dA by dt is 0, but if the coil is rotating, then angle theta is changing, and therefore, the induced EMF is nBA sin theta d theta by dt. And in case A and theta are constant, but the field itself is changing, then it is minus nA cos theta dB by dt. You see here there is a plus sign because the derivative of cos theta is minus sin theta. Therefore, it is nBA sin theta d theta by dt. And depending on the situation, we can use any one of these relations. What is the direction of the induced EMF? That is given by Fleming's right hand rule. I have shown you the Fleming's right hand rule. You take your right hand, extend the thumb, the index finger and the middle finger, so that they are all mutually perpendicular. Then, as shown here, if this the index finger represents magnetic field and this represents the direction of the motion of the conductor, then the induced current is in this direction. This thumb represents the motion of the conductor, the index finger represents the direction of the magnetic field, then the direction of the middle finger shows you the direction in which current will be produced. That is the law, Fleming's right hand rule. Now, we have seen that EMF is induced if there is a change in the environment of the conductor, right? And now, let us worry about this negative sign that we put here, negative sign. Why is there a negative sign? That is given by Lenz's law. One way to find the direction of the induced current is to use Lenz's law. It states that the direction of the induced current or EMF is such that the magnetic field due to this current tends to destroy the very source that produced it. I will explain you in the next slide what this means. You see, we have a loop here and we bring a bar magnet with north pole towards this loop. The current produced in this loop would be such that the face of the loop becomes north pole, so that this north pole and this north pole, they repel each other. That is, this poor thing is trying to produce the current, but the current produced wants to destroy it. So, the current produced in the coil is in such a direction that the face of the coil facing this is north pole also, so that there is a repulsion. It tends to destroy the motion of this magnet which produces the current in the coil. Similarly, when we want to withdraw, then this face of the current in the coil is such that this face of the coil facing the north pole of the magnet is south, so that it now attracts it. There is attraction between the two. So, it is always the opposite. You see, if this is moving, then this motion tends to be destroyed so that it does not move in this direction. If it is moving in this direction, then the force between the magnetic field produced by the induced current is such that, or the magnetic field produced by the current is such that it attracts the magnet back. So, it is always in the opposite direction. The magnet is moving this way, the current sends it back. Magnetic moving this way, the current, induced current tends to pull it. So, it is always in the opposite direction. That is that why this negative sign is there. And you see, This is actually nothing but the law of conservation of energy. Lenz's law is nothing but the conservation of energy. You see, if you can take this simple example, suppose the magnetic field or the magnet moving towards this gives rise to current. So as we keep on moving, current can keep on being produced out of nothing, right? So this obviously cannot happen. Now this current is such that it tends to oppose this. So therefore, this poor magnet has to do work while going towards the coil. It is this work that results in the electric energy of the coil. So Lenz's law is another form of the conservation of energy. Now let us see the one of the important applications of the Faraday's law of induction. Let us now apply the law of induction of Faraday to a very important device called the electric generator or a dynamo. Here we have a magnetic field pointing in this direction from north to south, and this coil is rotating in the anticlockwise direction. So you can now apply the right hand rule of Fleming, and you can see that when this coil moves up, the current in this direction is produced. When this arm of the coil goes down, the current in this direction is produced. And these two arms are always in contact with the same slip ring. These circular things, they are called slip rings. And there are these copper brushes outside which tap the current. So take this situation. Now here the current is in the outer circuit, the current is like this, that is, it goes from this to this. Half a cycle later, this CD has come here and AB has gone there, right? So the currents now are in this direction, in the same direction, but AB and CD have changed places. And you can now see that in the outer circuit, the current is in this direction. In the outer circuit, its current is in this direction. It comes like this through this slip ring, green one. This goes and goes like this. So when this is the situation, when the coil is like this, this A, B, C, D are like this, then the current goes through the yellow slip ring. You can see that positive direction of the current. And in the outer circuit, through these brushes, it goes like this. And in the next half cycle, when the coil has gone, it was like this, it becomes like this. So this phase now has come here. So the direction of currents now you can work out again using the right hand rule. In the outer circuit now you can see the current goes through the green slip ring and the direction is this. That is, in the two half cycles, the direction of the current is reversed. In this half cycle, the current goes like this. In the other half cycle, the current goes like this. That is why I have put this symbol of alternating currents. In the next lecture, we shall study the alternating currents. So in accordance with Faraday's law of induction, currents are induced in the arms of the coil. The direction of the currents shown can be found by using Fleming's right hand rule. Arms AD and BC are parallel to the field, therefore their motion does not produce any induction in them. These arms AD and BC, they are parallel to the field and therefore according to this law they do not produce any induced effect. And the current induced in the coil is passed to a load in an outer circuit through the slip rings. The slip rings are always in contact with the same arm of the coil and allow the direction of the current in the outer circuit to reverse. The output becomes an alternating current like this. The current grows, becomes maximum, decreases to zero, and the next half cycle it goes to the negative direction to the maximum magnitude and comes back to zero. So this is the alternating current which this device, the electric generator or dynamo, produces. Now the advantage of if we want we can use this generator to produce DC, that is a current in the same direction. But that is not important because the AC has certain advantages. And what is the advantage of AC? That voltages can be stepped up or down with the help of transformers. So, at the power station, we can step up the voltages, transmit, and at the place of the consumer, we can bring the voltage down and supply to homes and offices and factories. So, that is the advantage of AC. DC cannot be dealt in this way. Now, let us see if you use this. Anyway, you can work with this figure also. This epsilon, the induced EMF, is given by NBA sin theta d theta. You remember somewhere we derived that expression, NBA sin theta d theta. So, d theta by dt is constant, and this, it is sin theta that is going to change this cyclically, right? So, therefore, the EMF is, has the shape of a sine curve. It is cyclic because of sin theta. And when theta is 0, when is it 0? When the coil is like this and magnetic field is like this. So that the normal to the coil is parallel to the field, theta is 0. There is no induced EMF. When it is like this, then theta is perpendicular to the magnetic field. Angle is 90 degrees and we have the maximum induced EMF. So, in one half cycle it goes like this. This is actually for DC. In the other half cycle, it goes like this. So, we have this kind of shape for the current that is produced or the EMF that is produced in the generator, in the AC generator. So, this I have explained because when theta is 0, the induced EMF is 0. When theta is 90, induced EMF is the maximum. And what is the maximum value? Maximum value is simply NBA. Now, the advantage again of this kind of generator is that we can have several coils. In particular, we can have three coils arranged at an angle of 120 degrees from each other, as I have shown here. And they, of course, are independent. And we have a rotating magnetic field. You see, let me explain this. You see, instead of a steady magnetic field, we can have a rotating magnetic field and the coil steady. You know, it is a relative motion that matters. So, if the coil is steady, magnetic field can move. If the magnetic field is steady, then the coil can move. So, the anything can be done. The coil can be moved or the magnetic field can be moved. So, here we have magnetic field which will be moving, rotating, and these three coils are independent and they produce independent EMFs. This is called three-phase generator. Each phase is at an angle of 120 degrees from the other. And what is the advantage of this? You see, the variation now, if I take the sum of these three currents, the three coils, blue one, the red one, and the black one, you can see that this, there is very little variation. It goes like this, right? There is very little variation. So, if I have a large number of coils, say instead of 3, I have 6 or even 12, then what happens? Then you will have a large number of such curves, and if you take the sum of these, then you will see that we have almost a steady current, steady. And the straight line, this green one, is common to all the three. That is why, and these are called three phases. You must be familiar with three-phase generator. So, if three-phase generator is nothing but three coils, either coils rotating or it is more convenient, the magnetic field is rotating and the coils are in this magnetic field and they produce currents. Whichever way you think of it, you can produce AC alternating currents by this generator. In the next lecture, we take up this alternating currents and see how they are different from the direct currents and how they are more important than the direct currents.